Blackstone Audio presents Saving the Bill of Rights, Exposing the Left's Campaign to Destroy American Exceptionalism by Frank Miniter. This book is read by John Pruden. The Preamble. Liberty isn't liberalism. The only good bureaucrat is one with a pistol at his head. Put it in his hand, and it's goodbye to the Bill of Rights. H.L. Mencken. Though my wife made me promise to behave, I just couldn't fabricate a fake chuckle when a professor at a New York cocktail party quipped to a group of academics, "As John Stewart said, if the events of September 11 prove anything, it's that the terrorists can attack us, but they can't take away what makes us American, our freedom, our liberty, our civil rights. No, only conservatives can do that." Half a dozen acolytes laughed like school children, but the professor, who teaches English at a New York State university, noticed my poker face. A moment later, he deftly moved within whispering distance before asking under his breath, "You're a conservative, aren't you?" I replied, "I cling to my guns and religion." His eyes flared mirth as he raised his wine glass to me as he said, "Sorry to be divisive, but you know, I really don't understand you conservatives. But I do try. I even went to a tea party just to write down all the stuff on their signs. Then I went to my office and studied the slogans, thinking I could use them in class, you know, as examples of free speech turned hate speech or something. But I still couldn't make sense of what those people were so miffed about. So I'll ask you, just what liberties do you conservatives think you're losing to us progressives?" The professor had an open-minded expression and a PhD from UC Berkeley. He sported carefully trimmed sideburns, a silver stud earring, and clothes that fell out of style with Archie Bunker. He thought of himself as tolerant, worldly, and en vogue. He referred to himself as a citizen of the world. He protested against the Patriot Act when President George W. Bush was still in office. He believed gays should be able to marry and that marijuana should be legalized. I was the starchy conservative, so he didn't see how I could possibly be a defender of individual liberty. So I fired both barrels in the hope he'd do the same. Let's see. I'm disturbed when the Supreme Court redefines the Fifth Amendment to say it's okay for state and local governments to seize land from one private person so they can give it to someone they prefer. I'm opposed to any government that, despite what the Second Amendment protects, says law-abiding citizens can't defend their lives and families with firearms. I'm rattled that the U.S. Congress was able to take away corporations' First Amendment rights during elections, even as Congress passes taxes targeting particular industries. I find it remarkable that our federal government has been able to discount our 10th Amendment, the right that stipulates that all powers not expressly given to the federal government in the Constitution are reserved for the states or the people. I am dismayed when I see a progressive movement afoot attempting to shackle our First Amendment freedom of the press with censorship spun into fairness doctrine or net neutrality. I'm troubled that the Fourth Amendment's right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures has not always included my computer and cell phone. I'm horrified when my government requires me to buy not just health insurance, but their version of health insurance, even as they exempt themselves. I'm aghast that our government is spending so recklessly. It is putting American independence in the hands of Chinese communists. Basically, I'm tired of a government that treats my life as a puppeteer, all the while assuring me it's for the collective good. Aware that I was rudely filibustering, I relinquished the floor. His eyes tightened, then crossed. He really didn't know what to say. He finally raised his wine glass again, smiled, and began his counterattack. "I can counter all those points, you know, but I'll start by saying you conservatives too often let religion get in the way of the people's rights. But thankfully, we have a wall from our First Amendment separating your churches from the state, a wall you'd like torn down." "There is no wall," I replied. As his eyebrows hit the ceiling, I continued, "Actually, in 1947, Justice Hugo Black pulled the phrase wall of separation between church and state out of a letter President Thomas Jefferson sent to the Baptist Association of Danbury. Justice Black used the quote out of context. When read in its entirety, the letter clearly states that Jefferson saw the First Amendment as a restriction on the federal government's ability to sanction a state religion, hence the First Amendment's Establishment Clause. I'll have to look into that, he pondered aloud as his eyes searched his shoes before rising back to mine. But you know, what the Christian right really can't reconcile is the science Darwin unearthed, and so, like people, the government must evolve. No, you're not being accurate, I replied. The truth is actually more interesting than your ahistorical view. Here's what I mean. It's ironic that liberals today embrace Charles Darwin's theory of evolution, the belief that the strong prevail in nature while the weak go extinct, while at the same time they place Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations under their collective heels, a book that can be boiled down to an argument that government should simply provide a just arena so that business can attempt to outcompete their competition. True capitalism assures us that only the fittest survive, just like in nature. It's actually all the more ironic when you realize that Darwin was clearly guided by Smith's invisible hand. Darwin most certainly studied Smith. But religious conservatives attacked Darwin from the start, pointed out the professor as his voice wavered uncertainly. I was shaking my head as I answered. Sorry, Professor, that's revisionist history. People have forgotten that Darwin's Origin of Species wasn't that controversial when it was first published in 1859. Even the church didn't have a big problem with it then. It was Darwin's publication of The Descent of Man in 1871 that was controversial. That book, unlike Origin of Species, was not substantiated with scientific evidence, but was built on suppositions. Maybe, he said, but come on, you conservatives don't like evolution now. No, I know very few conservatives who completely tank the theory of evolution. What conservatives find objectionable is the false premise that evolution must mean, if true, that atheists are right. But how can you draw any other conclusion? He asked. Here's what you're missing, I answered. In the second edition of On the Origin of Species, published in 1860, Darwin added the phrase, by the Creator, to the closing sentence. In fact, Darwin's stated view at the time was that God created life through the laws of nature. This is something even the Catholic Church is okay with. In fact, in 1950, the Vatican stated its official position with a papal encyclical stating evolution is not inconsistent with Catholic teaching. Is that really true? He asked doubtfully.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.